You're watching STV from Douala, Cameroon. Good evening and thanks for joining us. This is the English Prime Time on Spectrum Television. On our top stories, the government of the Central African Republic is reconstructing the country after years of civil war. A post-crisis action plan has been presented to the country's technical and financial partners in Yaoundé today. In this newscast, we look at the content of this plan. Common law lawyers entered day two of their four-day protest in controversial fashion as a key member of the Bar General Assembly in the Northwest region resigns following a statement from another member in the Southwest region, distancing the Cameroon Bar Association from the move of the lawyers. We shall be looking at how the protest has been ongoing in Kumba in the Southwest region. Those are the top stories. Good evening. Once again, thanks for joining us. Members of government and civil society organizations from the Central African Republic have presented their post-crisis action plan to their technical and financial partners in Yaoundé today. In the upcoming report, our reporter Larinette Apaji sought to find out from the level of assistance provided by the international community, their motive, as well as why the meeting is taking place in Yaoundé rather than Bangui. Her report.
For about 4 years, the Central African Republic has suffered from civil unrest which has provoked the displacement of more than 1 million persons and has left 2 million citizens with the status of refugees in neighboring countries like Cameroon. The government of the Central African Republic has drawn a post-crisis and economic recovery plan which they have deliberated upon with their technical and financial partners during their SIF meeting this Wednesday in Yaoundé ahead of the general meeting.
You know, 6 months ago, a president and a government were elected in Central African Republic, and they will now present on November 17 in Brussels a plan to the donors and the technical partners.
The technical and financial partners of the Central African Republic, comprising of the United Nations, European Union, World Bank, and diplomatic missions, insist that their support offered to the government of the Central African Republic in the post-crisis phase is only but technical.
Basically, in case of need, we are there with some consultants to help them. We know what other countries have done outside of Central Africa, and maybe we have some good experience to share with them. But one more time, the ownership of this document and the ownership of the plan is the plan of the president and the plan of the government.
A point of curiosity is why an event concerning the Central African Republic is being held at the capital of Cameroon, Yaoundé, rather than Bangui.
That's because, of course, Cameroon is a very close partner to the Republic of Central Africa, but also because many ambassadors who are covering Central Africa are in fact based here in Yaoundé, and are covering both countries together.
Meantime, the humanitarian need of the Central African Republic remains enormous, as well as the need to consolidate peace.
The president of the Northwest Lawyers Union has resigned from his position as the permanent representative of the Bar General Assembly in the Northwest region. Barrister Bobga Harmony threw in the towel following a statement from his fellow counsel in Fako Division, Barrister John Kameni, distancing the Cameroon Bar Association from the ongoing protests of common law lawyers. The move appears to have split the Bar Association, as an official statement is highly awaited from the executive of the Cameroon Bar Association. We shall be coming back to this development in our subsequent newscast. Now we take you to Kumba, where common law practitioners have joined their colleagues in the Northwest and Southwest regions to protest to the four-day protest which began yesterday. Just like their peers, they have echoed similar calls for the common law to be preserved. Wana Henry.
Empty chairs and a quiet environment is the scenario that prevails at the Kumba High Court since Monday, October 10. The refusal of the Cameroon government to give a listening ear to the plea of common law lawyers on the high level of marginalization of the Anglophone judicial system is what has forced lawyers in Kumba to join their colleagues of the common law background on a strike action.
We already told all the judges and the presidents of the various courts that we are not coming, and we are sorry that there's nothing they can do about it, Minister. It's a fight. We are on strike. They have to understand that. Mm-hmm. Yes, we are not happy with the system. We are not happy. They have to hear us out.
The transfer of magistrates who are of French expression to the English parts of the Republic and who do not even master the common law system is what these lawyers are fighting against.
You see, what the government is trying to do is like trying to take away our identity. We are coming from a common law background. If you've happened to appear before the courts, things are not the way they were before. I'll give you an example. We are in a common law jurisdiction. As a common law advocate, you will not go to the court. And before the magistrate before whom you appear will be ordering you to make submissions in French just because he is a Francophone cultured magistrate who has been transferred to an Anglophone region. So we don't want this kind of situation.
In a case like the Kumba High Court that has 11 magistrates with 8 of them from the French expression, the common law lawyers have promised to stop at nothing to ensure that their voices are heard by the competent authorities.
In politics, the race for the head of the Northwest Bureau of the Social Democratic Front, the SDF, is getting heated by the day as candidates multiply strategies to woo their electorates. A divisional conference of SDF Mezam has taken place where candidates for the Northwest Elective Assembly were presented. Penmi Asheto.
The recent reorganization of wards and districts of the SDF in Mezam, which aimed at reawakening the party from slumber to the spirit of the 90s, a Mezam divisional conference was organized to chant ways forward for the party for future victories.
We are pushed with our backs to the wall because we have three councils down to the CPDM, and we want to do everything possible, to gain back these councils. There is the upcoming, regional elections, and Mezam, as the bastion of this party, has to prepare for that election. And that's one. And of course, the upcoming convention, we have to send our recommendations to that convention. The main message that I want the SDF in Mezam to carry home is that we are ready and set. At any time, even though Pobia has the political calendar in his pocket, we are set and we are going to take back our councils. Come even tomorrow, we are taking back our councils.
Representing the national chairman, Nijon Frundi, Honorable Chief Nji Paul Tumasang transmitted chairman salutations to the party militants and affirmed his good health. He equally attests the importance of the conference being the first of its kind.
Today is especially special because we are trying, we want the renaissance of the SDF as a political party to start from Mezam.
As the SDF prepares for its Northwest Regional Elective Assembly on October 22nd, the conference was apt for candidates to be made known so that delegates could go and elect them at the convention. Out of the two candidates vying for the post of the regional chair, only Honorable John Evaristus was given the floor to address some party constraints, a situation which most militants misinterpreted for campaign tactics against his opponent, to Sam Bernard, a feeling which party heads denied.
We now talk something else. Some 205 researchers have been admitted into the Ministry of Scientific Research and Innovation during the fourth scientific convocation of that ministry in Yaoundé today. It was a platform to valorize researchers and their role in the socio-economic development of the country. Yvonne Akko reports.
A total of 205 researchers from different grades have been recruited at the Ministry of Research and Scientific Innovation for the year 2015. A solemn march passed by these researchers during the fourth edition of their scientific convocation this October 12, 2016, marks the occasion to valorize researchers and their work and to inform the general public about their activities.
Research is the pillar of development, everything we do, be it socially, economically, technologically. So without research, look at what we eat today. in the whole world. You can eat maize now 3 times a year, and because of the production of research, there's research results. We now know about the problems that are happening, you know, the sociological, economical problems with displaced people in the far north, which is being done by the social science researchers.
In his expose during the convocation ceremony, Professor Jean-Louis Esame Eyono, a chief research officer, disclosed that the African continent loses about $4 million due to the transfer of technological know-how from the continent to the developed world. Yet he emphasizes that all hope is not lost, as many African researchers are returning home to create industries that will promote economic development and reduce unemployment.
We are here to identify problems and propose solutions to business people for them to implement.
David Mbak Akuro, a renowned researcher who has published over 100 articles in the domain of research, was distinguished for his contribution in the advancement of science and technology in Cameroon, Africa, and the world at large. Professor Jean-Louis Esame Oyono was distinguished with an Order of Valor, while Minister Madeleine Trente's bodyguard was equally rewarded for his devoted services.
Officials of the Douala Tree Council have launched a program to train bike riders in the municipality. With just 21,000 francs, they will be able to obtain a bike rider license. The goal of this initiative is to reduce motorbike-related accidents, as well as fight against urban disorder in the city of Douala. Muma Manda reports.
One of the many unpleasant things bike riders are famous for is the non-conformity to the rules in place and the proliferation of disorder. The majority of these bike riders have no knowledge about the regulations governing the road. This status quo is what council officials of Douala 3 are hoping to change in the near future. The council has partnered with the Littoral Regional Delegation of Transport and the Driving School to launch a special package that will permit bike riders to get trained, sitting for exams, and obtain a license at only 21,000 francs CFA.
So that is working with some of these syndicates of motor taxi, and they are ready. They met me already in the office to say they are ready. They had about 200 candidates already for the exams, and they wanted to launch it officially to encourage others who do not believe or who did not understand what it's all about. So today we feel that this message should go through, and we're going to do the exams and others who understand and come. We also had another message for them. We want to encourage them to do their immatriculation certificates so that they can have their immatriculation plates, because they need to be identified. You cannot ride a motor taxi when they don't know who you are. For security reasons, everybody needs to be identified. So the Ministry Delegation of Transport has facilitated this procedure, and we give them priority. We treat their documents first before others, because we actually want them to be useful and be important citizens in the future.
The special program will be carried out side by side the regular 9 annual sessions of the delegation. Groups as small as 40 will be examined before they receive licenses. The goal of the initiative is to reduce the number of motorbike accidents and to bring order on the road. As recommended by government, this action will help sell a better picture of Cameroon's economic capital during next month's female AFCON Games.
In health, the Douala General Hospital is organizing a series of brain storming sessions on some health complications. The week-long scientific days, which are opened on Monday, October 10, and ends on Friday, October 15, brings together experts from Cameroon and abroad. Focus on day 3 this Wednesday was on heart disorders in pregnant women. Darlene Fojo.
Pregnant at the age of 19, this young patient, presently under observation at the Douala General Hospital, needs special medical attention throughout her pregnancy to avoid complications during delivery. She is suffering from a peripartum cardiomyopathy, an uncommon form of heart failure which occurs during pregnancy, affecting over 1,000 pregnant women yearly. The underlying cause of this pathology is unclear, medics say, but the inflammation of the heart muscles and other risk factors such as obesity and multiple pregnancies can lead to the condition.
If you have, for the hypertension pregnancy, we know that it's genetic. Some people are just get it and others not. But if you're more obese, when you start your pregnancy, you have a higher risk of getting it. And for the disease which you get after delivery, you get a weak heart. It's called a peripartum cardiomyopathy. 1 in 1,000 women are getting that.
Though a majority of women with pregnancy-related cardiomyopathy make a full recovery after delivery, those with severe heart pumping problems are at risk of future complications and even death. The fetus is not exempted.
And it's a high risk for the mother and the baby. Both can die. Then you can have special diseases. You're totally fine before, and you develop like very high blood pressure in pregnancy. It's called preeclampsia, which is a big danger for the mother and the baby. And you can even have a condition where you are fine in the pregnancy, you give birth, you're still fine, and 1 to 3 months after delivery, very serious condition, and 20% of the women can die from that if they don't get medical treatment.
The scientific days organized by the Douala General Hospital grouped medical experts from Cameroon, Tanzania, South Africa, and other African countries to reinforce knowledge on such critical pathologies, very unknown by the population.
Because we are all teachers, okay? So, as I told you, we have to exchange our experiences, because I think you have followed at the maternity world. They talk about 3 cases of cardiovascular disease associated with pregnancy, with the complications, okay? So the impact is academic, is clinical for our populations, for our patients.
To avoid future complications, women with signs of cardiovascular-related conditions have been advised to seek medical views before getting pregnant.
Med division say they are satisfied with the progress made in the fight against HIV/AIDS. They have noted that many people are responding positively to the call to know their HIV status. These facts have been revealed during an ongoing free HIV screening campaign taking place in Kumba. Mama Manda reports.
The trends have changed. More people are now voluntarily showing up to get tested and to know for certain what their HIV status is. This was not the case in the past, where many shied away. This new outcome, medical officials say, can be linked to the introduction of the test and treat approach in hospitals. What this means is once a person is tested positive, he is immediately recruited for treatment. The numbers have thus increased and many more are feeling concerned.
Before test and treat, which was introduced I think a few months ago by the Minister of Public Health, we have in this center moved from the average monthly recruitment of new patients into treatment from 56 to about 68 now, which indicate a very big increase in new recruitments into treatment. And in the treatment center, I want to say, you look at our checklist, you look at our forms, you see that the number of people who are coming now for tests, to test for HIV, has really increased.
This positive attitude is being especially noted during the ongoing free HIV screening campaign in the city of Kumba. With more people aware and participating, officials reassure those who are concerned about the availability of antiretroviral drugs that there is enough for all in need.
We have not gone out of stock for any of our products for quite some time now. And despite the increase in the number of patients entering the treatment center, I don't think drugs can really be a problem.
The fight against HIV is gaining ground in this part of the Southwest region, and members of the technical group of the National AIDS Control Committee applaud this development.
Let's talk religion. Muslim faithfuls in Douala have prayed for the souls of their departed brothers as they observed the Islamic feast of Ashura today. Focus this year was on the need for peace and social cohesion in the world. Wana Henry.
The Ashura Annual Ceremony in the Muslim calendar is not just ordinary, but one which is punctuated with lot of emotions to pay tribute to departed Muslim faithfuls who, while on earth, contributed enormously to the growth of the Muslim faith. It is against this backdrop Muslim faithfuls in Douala all converge on their cultural center in Komondom Wednesday, October 12th, to thank Allah for the gift of life and the repose of the souls of their departed brothers and sisters. Drawing inspiration from this year's theme, which centers around social cohesion and peace in the world, Sheikh Hassam Sango Oseni urged the different Muslim faithfuls to be diligent in whatever they do on earth and to live an exemplary life of Imam Hussein, one of the finest spiritual fathers within the Muslim community.
And that takes us out of the country. I will make a stop in Nigeria, where 8 agencies warn that northeastern Nigeria is facing famine. The Boko Haram conflict has displaced over 2 million people, with militants destroying farms and stealing livestock, leaving the population with little or nothing to live on. Details with the VOA.
Around Maiduguri, you can see people lining up to get free food from charities. Sometimes, things get out of hand. About 1 million of the people displaced by Boko Haram have come here to Maiduguri. VOA was not allowed to film near the IDP camps. Inusa Issa rode out to meet us. He said he has not eaten a solid meal in 5 days.
We are dying of hunger. Shortly after I came here, my wife died. We just lost a baby 3 days ago that my brother's wife gave birth to. My brother is dead. My father died not too long ago.
The UN World Food Program has been handing out free supplements for children under 2 years of age since July. But some are ending up in health clinics, like this one, run by the International Rescue Committee.
They'll have swelling in both their legs due to protein wasting. We'll also see skin breakdown because, again, of protein wasting. We will see severe pneumonias because of when you start to feed, it'll go down into the breathing tube. We will also see congestive heart failure because their bodies are just not able to handle the fluid that comes into their body when we start to feed them.
2-year-old Maryam Ali could barely walk when she arrived at the clinic. Her dusty red hair, a telltale sign of vitamin deficiency. Her family had fled Konduga, about 40 kilometers away. She has recovered enough for her mom to feed her a nourishing peanut-based supplement. Staff say the sooner parents bring their children for treatment, the better. Doctors Without Borders treats the most severely malnourished children in this 110-bed facility. Dr. Jarvid Ali says at least 72 children died here in August.
In other parts of Africa that I've worked in or in Asia, it's usually a chronic situation that at a moment leads to malnutrition or humanitarian crisis. But here, it's very acute. It happened more or less overnight.
He estimates 1 in 7 children in the Borno State capital are malnourished. The situation in rural areas is a top concern.
Only 48% of Borno today is accessible, so we don't even know what the true magnitude is.
MSF has called for a massive relief effort. Nigeria's Emergency Management Agency responded with a statement that the situation in Maiduguri is stable. But people like Inusa look for food every day. Today, he got lucky. Chika Odua, VOA News in Maiduguri, Nigeria.
Sports in this newscast. The Chantal Biya International Cycling Tour kicks off tomorrow, Thursday, with the first lap from Yaoundé to Betwa. And kickoff time is 10 a.m. The 9 teams to participate in the cycling tour have been unveiled in Yaoundé today, as Larry Nedapaji reports.
Morocco,
Ivory Coast, Rwanda, Slovakia, Switzerland, France and Cameroon. These are the countries that will be partaking in the 16th edition of the Chantal Biya International Cycling Tour in Cameroon to kickstart Thursday, October 13, 2016. 9 teams will participate in the 4-day Chantal Biya International Cycling Tour, that is 2 teams from Cameroon, 2 from France and 1 from each of the other countries.
This is practically my eighth time of participating. And we, the Cameroonians, we are 2 teams, the Essence Blue Club and the original cycling from Cameroon.
We're here for maybe 10th time in Grand Prix Chantal Biya. We hope to fight for the good results in that beautiful race in Cameroon.
The first lap of the cycling tour Thursday will be for a distance of 122.7 kilometers from Yaoundé to Bafia. Friday, the cyclists will cover a distance of 155.3 kilometers from Yaoundé to Eboloa. On Saturday, they will also cover a distance of 131 kilometers from Zoetele to Meomesala, while the final lap will be on Sunday from Sangmelima to Yaoundé for a distance of 169 kilometers.
And there is a lot of work. I work today, yesterday, this night and today to find some arrangement with the rules of the organization, because there is a lot of mistakes and I have to find solutions for that, therefore. And for the rest, I know many of the riders from Africa and from Europe. I think they are very fair play, and I hope we see four days very good race. I hope so.
The cyclists will cover in total a distance of 578 kilometers before the winner is known.
With barely 1 month to the start of the 2016 African Cup of Nations, the female version, inhabitants in Boya have expressed fears over the non-completion of certain projects earmarked for the tournament. Works at the Moleko and Boya Town Stadia to serve as training facilities for the tournament are still making baby steps. Ebune Welindi spoke to some Boya inhabitants and put together their views in this report.
From the construction of various infrastructure to the demolition and renovation of structures along the Boya main road, all to give Boya a facelift as it awaits visitors. But almost a month left for the kickoff of the female AFCON, is the town of Boya ready?
Looking at all what is happening in Boya at this point in time, from so many perspectives or from so many point of view, you will discover that technically Boya is gradually getting into the shoes of being prepared to host this competition. But when we look at the infrastructure, you will discover that at the Moleko Omispo Stadium, even the Boya Town Green Stadium, construction works are still ongoing.
I think we are about 70% done, but I don't think we're going to meet up with the time or the date when the AFCON will be starting. That's on the 19th of November. I don't think, although Boya is a bit far of what we was last time, I think for now we are 70%, and I think somehow we're going to be 90% by then.
At the Moleko and Boya Town Stadia, work has been intensified as their major challenge is to finish at the end of the month. Therefore, in order to prevent such hasty work during the male AFCON,
the government should do all it takes to prepare way ahead of time for any competition of this magnitude, because we all know that most of the work that is going on now is as a result of the pressure of the deadline of the competition.
However, with the intensification of work here and there, all to prepare this nation for the upcoming AFCON, it is certain that come November 19th, the female AFCON will kickstart in Cameroon.
And that puts a cap on this edition of the English Prime Time on Spectrum Television. We want to thank you very much for watching. From the team and myself here in Douala, we wish you a good night. Bye-bye.